Thank you all for joining us today to discuss an issue that is vital to the future of our city and our nation, the 2020 Census. This year's census comes at an unprecedented time. As we face a public health crisis and a global economic downturn, it is crucial for our community to be fully counted and to secure the funding we are entitled to for critical services like education, medical care, mass transit, job training. I'm pleased to be joined by several of our partners who are working tirelessly to ensure that every New Yorker is counted in the census. Julie Menon, New York City Census Director, Councilmember Carlina Rivera, co-chair of the New York City Council 2020 Census Task Force, Melva Miller, Executive Vice President of the Association for a Better New York, Juan Rosa, Northeast Director of Civic Engagement at Naleo Education Fund, Amy Torres, Director of Policy and Advocacy at the Chinese American Planning Council, Derek Perkinson, National Action Network, New York City Field Director, Amita Anab, Census 2020 Senior Fellow at New York Immigration Coalition. It is time for us to fill out our census forms. If you haven't already, it's very simple. You can do it online, by phone, or through the mail. More than 52% of households have already completed their census, either online or phone or mail. Unfortunately, our district is lagging far behind the national average, with just 42% of households responding. I know we can do better. We did better 10 years ago. Of course, we've got a lot of challenges with the crisis, but we have to get our people counted. Otherwise, we will not get the representation we deserve and the services that we deserve in our communities. As chair of the Committee on Oversight and Reform, I am working to ensure every member of Congress and the American public know what is at stake in the 2020 census. And that's why I'm proud to announce a new program we're starting in the Oversight Committee and the Subcommittee on Civil Rights. We've developed a staff report showing the impact of the 2020 census on our district, and it will be available for every single congressional district. We thought this was so important that the committee is now creating similar reports for all the congressional districts, not only in New York, but across the country. This new report makes it clear that a complete census count is essential for our community. Every eligible person who gets counted in the 12th district brings in over $3,700 in federal funding for schools that serve low-income students and $470 for job training centers and career counseling. But if just 1% of people are not counted in our district, we could lose over $430,000 in school funding and $320,000 in job training funds. That is the equivalent of all the textbooks that 101,700 students need in a school year. And that's why I am calling on every New Yorker to respond to the census today from the comfort of your own home. Log on to my2020census.gov and respond, or call 844-330-2020 to respond over the phone. You do not have to be a member of Congress to shape the future of our community for the next 10 years. This funding formula will be in place for 10 years. So if we don't get people counted, we are going to lose literally millions of dollars for our neighborhoods and our communities. You only need to fill out your census form. With that, I'm going to turn it over to my good friend Julie Menon, New York City's Census Director, who has been a driving force in ensuring every New Yorker is counted. Thank you all for tuning in, and Julie, you're on.
Thank you so much, Congressmember Maloney, and I really want to thank you for your unwavering leadership on the census and helping New York City, and we are thrilled to partner with you on making sure that New York City receives a proper count, and I want to thank all of the other speakers who are speaking as well today. So as the Congress member said, we are below the national average. So I'm going to give statistics that are as of yesterday. We are, the city as a whole is at 42.6%. The nation as a whole is at 53.2%. In terms of New York Congressional District 12, we have some areas that are well above that, such as Stuytown and Peter Cooper Village, in excess of 60%. Those numbers are on par with other parts of New York City, such as Washington Heights and Inwood, that also have a higher than city average. But then we have parts of the district, such as the Upper East Side at 36.6% and Midtown at 31.4%. Part of the reason why we think some of those numbers are lower, and it's a problem that we're having, is that people are under the misimpression that if for any reason they have left New York City during COVID, they still believe that they need to have the paper form with a computer code. That is absolutely not accurate. You can fill the census out from any phone, from any computer, wherever you might be. And so we really need to double down on getting that message across. COVID is really a very stark reminder of why the census is so important. So to put this into context, in 2010, only 61.9% of New Yorkers filled out the census at the end of the self-response period. We're obviously in the middle of the self-response period and we're at 42%. If you compare that in 2010 to the national average of 76%, New York City was well over 14 points behind. So why am I mentioning 2010? Well, when we look at funding for our hospitals, all the funding that we need for PPE, for ventilators, we honestly would be in a very different situation in New York City if in 2010 more New Yorkers had filled the census out. So COVID is unfortunately a stark reminder of why it matters so much. As the Congress member's report shows, and this report is so invaluable because I think for many New Yorkers, they need a reminder of why this matters to their daily life. You can really see the city as a whole receives $770 million a year in Title I funding. In congressional district that the Congress member represents, you can see that a 1% undercount would mean a loss of $430,000 to the district, which is really very stark. I will just end with a couple points about what we're doing. So we have, in light of COVID, been focused on phoning and textathons. Just this past week, this is the fourth textathon we've done. It just on April 23rd alone, we texted over 1 million New Yorkers using Hustle, which is peer-to-peer texting. We're working with all of our community partners on texting. We're working with the city council. We organized with them a textathon. And that really matters. We also have pulled back in the first week of COVID, we pulled back our subway ads. We converted that to TV ads, digital ads. So on the TV ads, you might have seen some of our ads, whether they're with Cardi B or our other ads that we're running right now. We are running much more on TV, on radio, and on digital and multi-language. And then the last thing I'll mention is we're going to be holding a large Census Sunday event with hundreds of houses of worship. We're doing that on two Sundays in May. So that's another way that we're reaching New Yorkers. So thank you so much to Congresswoman Maloney, and thank you to all the partners who are participating today.
Thank you. We're now going to go to Carlina Rivera, the co-chair of the New York City Council 2020 Census Task Force. Is Carlina here?
I'm here. Can you hear me?
Great. Yes. Great. Great to see you.
Great to see you too, Congresswoman. Thank you so much for having this press conference. I want to thank you for releasing the report. It paints a very stark picture of the exact risks that we face from an undercount in the 2020 census. And I want to thank Julie Menon, who is always so concise and eloquent in speaking on the millions of federal dollars that we can lose for low-income students and job seekers and key infrastructure projects, and how we performed worse than the national average. And we don't want that to happen this time around. And we certainly face some extreme challenges. And to everyone who is going through this crisis, please know that this is a way that you can do something for your community. This is how we can make sure that for the next 10 years that we can tell a story on how we came together united to fill out the census, because we know we need the resources. So while we have done everything to make sure that people are filling out their census forms It's clear that the COVID-19 pandemic is creating unprecedented obstacles in our effort. And all the work that we put in to ensure that neighborhood groups were receiving the funding they needed to conduct in-person outreach is now being converted to online efforts. And why that was so important to us is because these community-based organizations have spent years and even decades cultivating relationships. They're trusted in their communities. And we had such an exciting, robust, grassroots, you know, on the ground, door knocking organization and infrastructure that we were actually really, really excited to have these conversations. So, you know, we have asked for an extension to do some of this work. As was mentioned, we hosted our first census text-a-thon in partnership with the Mayor's Office of the Census, with 30 council offices participating and reaching out to thousands of New Yorkers in their districts. And with less than half of the New York Census forms completed, it's imperative that our federal, state, and local governments continue to provide additional resources for outreach and flexibility as we fight for a complete count in the Empire State. So that's why I've called for the census enumeration period to be extended. I look forward to working with Congresswoman Maloney on this effort in the days and weeks to come. And while I'm certainly pleased that Manhattan is trying its best, you know, some of our outer boroughs and those numbers are troubling. Just generally, I wanna make sure that all of our numbers are better than ever. We certainly want a complete count. This is so, so important. It's very, very personal in terms of my own upbringing on WIC and living in Section 8 and understanding how important it is to subsidize so many of our programs and services that our families count on. So we're counting on you, New Yorkers. We're counting on everyone to make sure that we get our fair share in billions in funding and, of course, to keep the political representation that is fighting for us in Washington. Thank you so much, everyone.
Our next speaker is going to be Melva Miller, the Executive Vice President of the Association for a Better New York. Melva.
Yay, Melva.
Good morning. Hey, thank you so much, Congressmember Maloney, for highlighting just how important it is to get an accurate count and how much it costs when there is an undercount in our communities. You know, all on this call has really, we've all been working feverishly to improve the self-response rate. And with the challenges with COVID-19, we've just had to ramp up those efforts even more. And the census is about money, power, and resources in our communities for the things that we care about. And when we think about it, an undercount in the census means underfunded in our communities. It's plain and it's simple. And when federal funding gets cut, it's usually communities of color, communities that are at risk that are affected the most. And we often are the hardest to count to begin with. And that means better schools, better healthcare, better roads, better housing, better services. That's what's at stake in the 2020 census. And the Congress member's report really illustrates that really eloquently for that district. For every individual and community that goes undercounted, millions of dollars that should go to our local schools, our hospitals, our organizations, and for businesses are lost. And it's our count, it's our community, and it's our future. And a complete count is more important now than ever because of the health care of our loved ones as we deal with COVID-19. The census tells us and tells government what they need to know and where they need to send these resources, like hospital beds and supplies to our communities, and where the allocation of services should be. You know, census data supports funding for school lunches, right, for first responders. All of the people who are on the front lines right now fighting for our communities and making sure that they stay healthy. And as we, and particularly as we look to restart our economy, we need all the help we can get. And by completing the census, we will make sure that government-funded programs such as small business grants and loans, unemployment insurance, Medicaid, childcare, community health centers are available when we need them the most. And jobs, right? The census determines where businesses bring jobs, whether it's supermarkets that use census data to open new locations in vulnerable communities, whether it's pharmacies that use census data to determine how many languages and how many pharmacists we need in certain areas, and whether it's just government using data to determine how and where to support CDFIs, right? The Community Development Financial Institution Funds that play important roles in generating economic growth and opportunities in some of our nation's most distressed communities. Financial institutions have specific low interest lending products and they use their CRA credits in certain neighborhoods based on census data. These are all the tools we need to restart our economy after COVID-19, and census data is going to determine that. It's census data that is critical and necessary as a tool as we use to restart our community, and we can't afford to miss out. We can't afford to be undercounted. And Congressmember Maloney's report spells this out, and I thank you for that. It's our community, it's our count, and it's our future, and we will all stay steadfast, and we need to make sure that we get each and every one of our family, friends, and community members to complete their census form, because the next year is going to be the toughest, and it's going to be unprecedented in how we sort of restart and get back to normal. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Melba. Our next speaker is Juan Rosa, Northeast Director of Civic Engagement of Naleo Education Fund. Thank you.
Thank you so much, for Congresswoman, for having Naleo join you today. I'm so pleased to be with many of my colleagues, including Director Menin and Councilwoman Rivera. Naleo Educational Fund holds that a census that doesn't count accurately and completely the second largest population group in America is a failed exercise. Therefore, our Hágase Contar campaign, Make Yourself Count, has been deployed around the nation, hosting train-the-trainer workshops, hosting a website where people can go for information and materials to spread the word about census. We have a hotline, bilingual hotline, English-Spanish, that is operational 12 hours per day, 5 days a week, where people can call for information on how to complete the census and to demystify any doubts they have about the census. New York, we are in the eye of the storm. We've been in the hardest hit area from COVID-19. Certainly, Melba and others have spoken before have noted how important it is in the midst and because of COVID that we respond to the census. The census determines where federal funding is allocated, but also where political power is allocated. And as we go into an era of recovery and reconstruction of our economy, of our society, we'll need political power now more than ever. And the census, the decennial census, determines how political lines are determined. It's very important to remind people that the census is mandated in the Constitution. Our Constitution mandates that every 10 years, we go out and count how many people, regardless of citizenship status, immigration status, gender, economic, or racial characteristics, how many people live in the United States every 10 years, so that we can then go out and redraw political lines to make sure that we divide political power equitably amongst the states. That is what the census is about. It's about a political power. It informs how the federal government invests resources. And COVID-19 has really, really brought the point home of why government needs accurate data on who lives where in our communities. At Naleo, we're proud to partner with the City of New York, again, led by Director Menin, in making sure that organizations on the ground, advocates on the ground, have the right resources, the right information to talk to residents in their language about why census is important, how our schools benefit from census, how our hospitals benefit from census. We'll continue to do this work. And now we're doing it in the digital space, hosting Facebook Lives, hosting Instagram Live events, making sure that we're talking to influencers at the local level to ensure that they're equipped with the right information and the right resources to drive the point home that something that we could do to make our city better after the tragedy that we're living through is to make sure that our city is counted accurately and completely in the 2020 census. It's also very important that we tell people that while the timeline has been extended to October 31st, it's important that people self-respond. If you self-respond, you'll avoid having people from the census go to your doors during the summer to count you. So the more people, the more New Yorkers, the more Latinos, the more New Yorkers as a whole self-respond to census by internet, by phone, or by filling out the forms that were mailed out in the last few weeks, the better it is for us, because that means that census takers will not be at the doors starting in the summer. Thank you so much, Congresswoman.
Thank you. Next is Amy Torres, Director of Policy and Advocacy at the Chinese American Planning Council. Thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you, Congressmember Maloney. And I'm so pleased to stand alongside so many other fierce census champions for today's press conference. CPC, the Chinese American Planning Council, is the nation's largest social services organization for Asian Pacific Americans. We were founded in 1965. We've been deeply rooted in low-income immigrant and Asian American neighborhoods for 55 years. And we know as a social services organization that the communities that we serve have been disproportionately and deeply impacted by the COVID-19 crisis. In New York City, some of the areas with the most linguistic diversity are also the areas that are have been hardest hit by the COVID-19 virus. We also know that neighborhoods that have systemically been disenfranchised and under-resourced are also struggling with recovery and meeting medical needs in their neighborhoods. So the call for a complete and accurate census count is more urgent than ever. We know that communities of color, immigrant communities, make up a disproportionate share of the essential workforce, of the healthcare workforce. And this crisis has really underscored the need for accurate and complete data so that we can drive the resources that are needed back to the communities that need them most. So, as these systemic disparities and inequalities have been highlighted by this crisis, we know that the nation's attention is tuning into these needs in a way that in many ways we never have before. And we are so pleased to stand alongside of our partners to really seize on that moment to talk about how we start to undo some of that underrepresentation, that under-resourcing through a fair and accurate complete count. It's really important to make sure, as Councilmember Rivera mentioned, that the community organizations that have that deep trust, that deep relationship with hard to reach and hard to count communities are also able to seize the extended timeline that was granted through the Federal Bureau, and making sure that right now we're using every resource that we can, whether it's text banking, phone banking, whether it's flyering in our meal deliveries or in our grocery drop-offs, that we're reminding as many people as we can to fill out their census now, in the hopes that once we're out of the New York on pause directive, that we're really able to get into the communities that have been the most impacted, that have been traditionally the hardest to reach and hardest to count, and making sure that we're spending all of our energy and efforts on them as well. This report that Congresswoman Maloney has put out has really underscored the need for that. Every dollar counts in a period of crisis. And we're not just looking at the period of crisis and the road to recovery, but the next 10 years ahead. So we want to remind everyone that you're not done once you fill out the census. Once you fill out the census, it's more urgent than ever before that you're getting your friends, your families, the rest of your network, and your entire community counted as well. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Derek Perkinson from the National Action Network. He is the New York City Field Director.
Hi, good morning, everyone. Are you guys hearing me well? It's good to see a lot of you. Like Amy, I echo Amy's sentiments. A lot of you guys are on the front lines. We're on the front lines together in this fight. And I thank the Congresswoman. She's been on the front lines for years in this fight. And I salute you, Congresswoman. The National Action Network is a civil rights organization founded by Reverend Dr. Al Sharpton and Attorney Michael Hardy. And back in 86, when they started the organization, it was for civil rights and social justice for people of color and minorities, disenfranchised. Now it's grown 30 years. We'll be 30 years old soon. So we're still in a fight on a lot of different issues with voting rights. And census is one of the things that we're focusing on. We've been pushing a lot to our networks. We also have a meal distribution network that we're doing nationwide, but also here in Harlem, 106 West 145th Street, every day, Monday through Saturday. I only bring that up to say we just got some census bags. So now when people come get the meal distribution, We have the actual U.S. Census bags to put the food in. So we're pushing that out every day. We're giving out 2,500 meals a day. So we're reaching a lot of people daily. Coronavirus, COVID, is impacting us to do physical contact, to go in people's face 6 feet of social distance is the requirement, and we have to abide by that. I'm a solution-driven guy, and I want to find solutions to this problem. Everyone else before me, they spoke to the needs and the importance of the census very articulately, so it doesn't make sense to rehash that. What do we do to get these people counted? We're at, like the Congresswoman said, we're at 48%, which is very bad. And to get out of COVID, we're going to need this money to help us get out of this situation. So I'm suggesting, because I had an idea at the House of Justice, the line is from the door all the way to the corner. I don't know if people, a lot of people have been to the House of Justice. It's all the way up the block. I mean, hundreds of people are lined up. We need someone in hazmat suits, clipboards, to go physically and engage people. Juan hit on something that I was using right before the COVID started, and it was working wonderfully. If you do not want someone knocking on your door, complete the census online or by phone. People do not want people knocking on their door. People love their privacy. They do not want anyone knocking on their door for a census. Now, another point, again, the hazmat suits and engaging meal distribution census citywide should be one part of the strategy. The hazmat suits should be another part. And what I'm trying to say was, I lost my train of thought really quick, but to get these people counted is very important. We have to engage them where they're at. These meal distribution centers citywide are an opportunity to get the food insecure, which are mostly the demographic that always missing in the count are Black men and young children. So we know a lot of men and children are coming to the House of Justice to do this stuff. So we're also going to partner with 100 Black men. They're one of the beneficiaries of a grant and help them push their initiative here in Harlem. And I'm trying to partner with a lot of other organizations to help with the census. We're not getting grant money, but we want to help everyone that's getting grant money to make as much as an impact and have a much as complete count as we can. Thank you for your time, guys.
Well, thank you for your ideas and your energy, all of you. Thank you. Our last speaker is Mita Anand. She's the Census 2020 Senior Fellow at the New York Immigration Coalition.
Thank you so very much, Representative Maloney. And it's a real pleasure to be here with you, with Councilmember Rivera, and of course with Director Menin, and with all of my fellow census magic makers. So I wanted to emphasize a few points since I'm going last. I think a lot has been covered, and I think it's really important to emphasize a few points. Right now, New York State is ranked number 43 in the response rate of the nation. We need to be at least at average, not the 43rd down. And New York City is lagging New York State. We do not want the census to be another victim of the coronavirus. And that is what it is right now. It's a victim of COVID. We need the resources that a fair and accurate census would give us. As others have emphasized, it gives us the resources for healthcare and hospitals, for school lunches. It allows us to determine the languages we need, the language services that people need when they go to hospitals or schools. It also means we get representatives like Carolyn Maloney who fight for New Yorkers in DC to make sure we are getting our fair share and that we are being taken care of. What COVID has done is laid bare the inequities in our society. And one way for us to get back to even the playing field is to make sure we are participating in the census at 100% so that we can get our fair share of resources and representation. As others have mentioned, outreach has suffered because of COVID, and that makes sense. We at New York Immigration Coalition, and through our role as facilitator and convener of New York Counts 2020, and along with the organizations on this call, we have come up with new and creative ways to do outreach. But there are limits, and we see that based on the response rates that we have. What we need is for everyone to lend their voices, to lend their efforts, to make sure wherever they are talking about the census. What we know at the New York Immigration Coalition is that the communities we serve are the ones being most impacted by COVID. Economically, medically, it is devastating. And for these people, they also are demonstrating the lowest response rate. Our communities have a low response rate, and we do not blame them. This is an incredibly hard time, but we need to find ways to reach out to them and make sure that we can help them fill out the census so that their vulnerabilities do not extend for the next 10 years. So what can we all do at this time? Everyone has said it. Not only do we all need to fill it out, we need to turn around and make sure everyone else around us is filling it out. I live in Congresswoman Maloney's district. I wrote an email to my building because I was following the rates and I saw the numbers that Julie Menon just talked about. And everyone can do that. You can talk to the small business down your street and say, put up a poster. And everyone can just make sure that they convert themselves to a census ambassador, because without having that outreach that we haven't been able to do, we are not going to be able to turn it around. So with that, I want to emphasize one last thing, which is that a lot of us feel like there's not much we can do in this time, but there is something we can do, and it's something that helps all of our communities, and that is fill out the census and tell everyone we know to tell everyone they know to fill out the census. So thank you so much for this opportunity, and back to you, Congresswoman.
Thank you so much. Thank all of you for the work you're doing, and we have to get our numbers up. That's why we're doing this call, and I hope every member of the New York delegation will have these reports done for theirs, and we can do a report on how the undercount of 1% would impact our city and our state. I'm now gonna turn it back to the moderator to see if there's any questions from the press. Again, I'm inspired by all your hard work. I'm gonna work even harder on ideas to get the word out. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Once again, if you have a question for the Congresswoman or any of our esteemed guests, press *9 if you are on a telephone, or raise your hand. It is an option in the Zoom app. Our first question comes from Hansi Lo Wong with NPR. Hansi, you are now unmuted and can ask your question.
Thank you. Representative Maloney, I wanted to ask, do you support extending the deadlines in Title 13 for census data for apportionment and for redistricting as requested by the Census Bureau? And do you expect Congress to address these requested extensions from the Census Bureau in the next coronavirus relief bill?
I do support it. We are drafting legislation that would secure this, changing apportionment from December 31st, 2020 to April 30th, 2021, and delivery of redistricting data to states on April 1, 2021 to July 31st, 2021. It's necessary given what we're confronting. We can't do the door-to-door enumeration, as our other speakers said. We have a tremendous challenge. We've had several meetings with the census director. They keep canceling them a lot of times, but we did have one on Friday, and he vowed he would get us in writing the exact plan that he has to move forward to get a fair and accurate count. We need to get that in writing and the explanation from their research of why this is needed and what they project in the future and how they will be working to make this count happen. Regretfully, we have to do this because of the COVID crisis. That as many of the speakers pointed out, that's one of the reasons we're undercounted now. But we have to, even with the crisis we're confronting, do everything we can to get our friends, our neighbors. I love the 8 o'clock, 7 o'clock meeting where we all go out and thank all the workers. I think I'm gonna go out and hold up a census sign too, just to remind people to think about making sure we have the funds for our healthcare workers by filling out this form. It's so critically important. And we have to adjust to the times, and the times have required some changes, and we will bring them about either through legislation or through COVID number 5, I guess it is, that we're gonna be moving forward. Thank you.
Our next question comes from Michael Schneider with the Associated Press.
Hi, my question is for the Congresswoman. If you could elaborate a little further, and I'd like to piggyback off Hansi's question, can you just kind of walk us through the legislative process and when you expect legislation to pass as far as the Census Bureau's request? And do you have any doubts that this will pass? I mean, are you confident that there won't be any objection in the House to this?
Well, I am supporting it. I reached out to four former directors of the Census, and they all support it. They think it's necessary. I have also reached out to every organization that is on this panel today, and they support it. I don't know one of our stakeholders in the whole country that is not supporting it. Everyone sees it as a necessity and a reality of what we're confronting now. They haven't been able to do many of the traditional ways that they've reached out, and very importantly, the door-to-door enumeration, which is particularly important in hard-to-count communities. We intend to put in a standalone bill that will either pass by itself or pass in another package, such as another COVID relief package. Those talks are underway. The next package will be originated here in the House of Representatives. The last one came from the Senate. In any event, I believe it will pass. We would like better coordination and oversight of the Census Bureau. We would like them to respond to our requests for meetings. We have asked them to meet with our oversight staff every week on where they are in the census. We want to be partners in making sure that things are happening, that the pieces are being put in place to have this critical count. As it stands right now, and why I'm sounding the alarm on New York, is we are way behind. We are a remarkable city. We are a city built for a crisis, and no one could do a better job in responding to COVID than New York City. Not only are we treating people, every bed, we move from 50,000 beds to 90,000 beds. We are now giving ventilators to other states because we have enough, but we're also conducting a great deal of the research on treatments, on vaccines. Our hospitals are leading the way and totally committed to the next step of finding a way to cure people, immune, or to vaccinate people. So we're working hard, but it has taken a toll. The lockdown has taken a toll. It's hard for us to communicate with our neighbors and our friends because we are locked in our homes, but we've got to figure out a way. That's why we have so many outstanding community organizations reaching out. And of course, I thank the mayor and Julie Menon for their deep commitment to this with advertising that they're paying for here in the city to make people aware. Cardi B did a great job, and we thank her. I tried to get her on this forum. She would have added a lot of zip to it, maybe a new song or rap she could have put out on it. But we've got to get this census done. I'm very, very concerned because, as was pointed out by so many of our speakers today, we are far behind where we were 10 years ago. And we need, everything's gotten better with more people counted with every year. Now we are behind. We have to catch up. And what this report shows, that this is real, real numbers that we will lose for healthcare workers, transportation, education, and others. Thank you.
Our next question comes from Michael McEnone with CQ Roll Call.
Hi, yes, this is a question for the Congresswoman. I wanted to know, the legislation that you're looking at, is it solely based on the Census Bureau recommendation, or are you looking at additional provisions? I'm thinking about the citizenship data product that the president ordered to be produced, or changes for more flexibility for, say, sick leave for the temporary census workers that might not normally be covered under federal policy?
We are looking at oversight, and we are looking at having a cooperation on an ongoing way to have that oversight. We should not be adversaries. We are supportive to the Census Bureau doing a complete and accurate count. We may write in some oversight requirements because we've had such difficulty. For one complete month, we were trying to meet with the census director, and he has canceled at the last minute twice. He says it was important reasons, but he did cancel. We want to make sure that we do have access to the census director, that our staff has access to where they are proceeding in each state. Are they moving forward? Are they getting to the hard to count? Are they treating the rural areas with the attention they need, and the undercounted areas with the attention they need? We want to make it clear that the censorship question is not part of it, and it's absolutely confidential, that no information will ever anybody else. And if they did share, it is criminal. It's absolutely criminal. So it is private information. We just want an accurate count. If anything, we will be adding language that would help us ensure an accurate account and oversight.
All right, it looks like we have one question remaining. Again, if you have a question for the Congresswoman or any of our guests on today's call, please either raise your hand in the Zoom app or press star 9 if you are on a telephone. And our next question goes to Yi Wang from Cinovision.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, my first question is, why is New York's response rate extremely low this year? And because of social the second question is because of the social distancing. So it's very hard for the census workers to go from door to door. So how are you going to fulfill this purpose to make sure everyone is responds to Census 2020?
Is this to me or who is it to?
This is for Congresswoman and for Commissioner.
Okay. Well, I think that one of the reasons that it's been put off is that we hope at one point we'll be able to go door to door. At this point, we can't. And it's hard to predict what happens in the future because it really depends on the response that we are able to achieve with the coronavirus. If we are able to bring down our infection numbers, if we're able to really test everybody so that we know you're safe, you know who has it, who doesn't have it, so that we can make sure that other people are not infected. It depends on all of this, but we have to just go forward with the best that we can. And what we can do in Washington is really work and support the Census Bureau. If they need more funding, we'll be working to provide that. If they need more staffing, we'll be working to provide that. But we also need to see their numbers, their work, their plan of how they're going for it. I have asked for a detailed plan, not only to what led to this discussion or this decision, but also what are their plans to go forward to make an accurate count. I've been involved with the census ever since I went to Congress, and we've been able to get these types of reports and forecasts in the past. We need to get them now. Maybe they're overworked with COVID, whatever, but we need to get that plan. What is the saying? The Bible tells us Moses was in the desert for 40 years because he didn't have a plan. We want to see what their plan is so we can work with them to implement it. And it's a real crisis. As was pointed out by one of our speakers, if we didn't have an accurate count last time, I hate to think how underfunded our hospitals would have been. And even now, our hospitals are telling me that one of their biggest problems is they don't have the personnel. So many people are out sick. We've sent in 1,500 workers from the federal government, mainly from the military hospitals. We're trying to meet all of these demands, and it's difficult. I believe that's why the account is as it is, but we have to double down and reverse it. And I yield to Julie Menon, who has done an outstanding job. She's been at every meeting, every weekend, every forum, every idea that any of us has come forward to get help. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Congressmember Maloney. So I'm happy to address that question. We have to look back at 2010, where, as I mentioned at the top, our overall self-response rate was 61.9% at the end of the self-response period, without the fact that there is now in 2020 a pandemic. If we look at our numbers now, one of the biggest challenges we face, and we knew this going in before COVID, is one third of New Yorkers lack access to broadband. So you have a situation where one third of New Yorkers are not able to fill the census out online. And with an online census, this becomes more difficult than ever. The US Census Bureau made the unfortunate decision before COVID to really focus on the online part of the census. So in other words, they sent a mailer out on the first mailing to only 20% of New Yorkers. That is a problem. We strongly urge them to add an additional mailer, which they did. Quite frankly, they should be adding many additional mailers, because in a city like New York, where a third of New Yorkers lack access to broadband, and now with COVID, we can't have New Yorkers go into the public libraries or one of the 300 pop-up centers that we had set up, where New Yorkers could have gone in to fill out the census. The good news, however, obviously there's a good news part of my answer, is that eventually when the stay-at-home order is lifted, we will be able to open those 300 pop-up centers that we had set up. We quite frankly don't know when that will be, but we will be able to boost those numbers once the order is lifted.
All right, there are no more remaining questions. And with that, I will turn it over to the Congresswoman to finish us out.
I just want to thank all of you for taking the time to join me. I want to thank the press because there's no story unless the story gets out. So thank you for your attention to this crucial issue. And all of my colleagues is in community and advocacy and government for all your hard work in joining us today to help get the word out. I'm deeply grateful. I learned a lot from all of you on what you're working on, and your enthusiasm has given me enthusiasm, even more enthusiasm for this task. Thank you to everyone, and let's keep working. Let's get our numbers up.